everyone. Good evening. All right, I'm going to start now. Sorry to interrupt, but we're ready to start. Okay, so welcome to everybody, both in the room and everyone at home. If you are at home and you want to ask a question during the Q&A session, you can just type into the Q&A box on Zoom, and someone here, a staff member, will read the question aloud. If you're in the room, of course, just raise your hand. There is closed captioning available in the remote session, and also the lecture will be recorded and made available at a later date. Now, I have a fire safety announcement to read. It's a prescribed wording, so I will read it now, and then I will go ahead and introduce our speaker tonight, Dr. Tom Nixon. All right, so safety first. There are no fire drills scheduled for the duration of this event. If the fire alarm sounds, please leave your belongings behind and calmly begin to evacuate the building. Your nearest fire exit is on the ground floor through the door you entered the center. Please assemble outside 28 Bedford Square to the right as you leave the building, and do not leave the area or attempt to return to the center until you have been advised it is safe to do so by a member of the PMC staff. All right, so on to the substance of our evening. So I am so delighted, could not be more delighted, to introduce Dr. Tom Nixon to give our lecture this evening. Tom is actually best known as a scholar of the art and architecture of medieval Spain, and particularly for his book about Toledo Cathedral, Building Histories in Medieval Castile. But in fact, he actually knows everything about late medieval architecture everywhere. So although he is a specialist in medieval Spain, actually he knows everything. And I think his specialization in visual culture of medieval Spain, medieval Iberia, is relevant in any number of ways to the subject of our lecture series. In fact, we've had conversations about the terminology of the Iberian Peninsula, Spain, that is very much analogous to the kinds of things we discussed in the initial lecture about how one can be very productively tongue-tied about the way in which one refers to the medieval instantiation of the countries that we know as the United Kingdom, Spain, and so forth. So he has that kind of conceptual connection to our material. But he also knows a great deal about the art and architecture of medieval England, particularly as it relates to the wider world, his term that he sometimes uses for that as well. So one thing that he's done, in addition to his extensive publications on these subjects, is he has created a master's course called England, Europe, and Beyond, Art, Identity, Trade, and Politics in the Middle Ages. Now, academics are extremely good at calling for things and then not doing them. We must have more courses like Tom's. And in fact, Tom has actually gone ahead and he's really done it. And not many people actually have the knowledge and intellect and imagination really to do that properly, but Tom does. So I could not be more happy that he accepted our invitation. So his contribution this evening is on Metamorphosis. Please, Tom.
Well, thanks, Jessica, for that very kind introduction. I'm not
sure I was very knowledgeable at the beginning of the process of teaching that MA, but certainly I've learnt a lot from my students and from last-minute preparation for seminars and so on as well. But thank you to Jessica and to Lloyd for the invitation to speak in this really interesting series, and to the PMC also for hosting me and this whole series. So really, what I want to ask tonight is, can we speak meaningfully of a global Britain in the Middle Ages? You might ask, can we speak meaningfully of a global Britain even now? But it is rare, very rare, for political rhetoric, the rhetoric of global Britain now, to align with disciplinary agendas, as it does in this case. But for me, at least, the so-called global turn in the humanities poses this question more urgently than any think tank paper. Where do medieval studies sit in a rapidly expanding global art history? This question has been posed for Europe more broadly and for places like Italy, but never specifically for Britain, at least as far as I know. Well, in the Middle Ages, as now, trade is central to questions of globality, and I'm going to talk about it a lot today. So it's striking that already in the 12th century Liberties of London, a series of regulations for London traders, we find mention of foreign merchants bringing goods from afar. These include pepper, cumin, and ginger grown in India or Southeast Asia, alum, a salt product used for dyeing found in Western Egypt and Chad, Brazil wood, a cloth dye extracted in India and Indonesia, and resin and incense, some of it probably from Arabia or India. Some of these products came along the well-established Silk Roads that passed from China and through Central Asia to Europe, but most probably came via the Indian Ocean, up the Red Sea, from Egypt to Venice, and thence to Northern Europe. So the movement of these goods underlines a key issue for medieval globality. I'm sorry to use that kind of horrible word, but anyway, it's kind of... It's so embedded in the literature that I can't avoid it. But this key issue, I think, particularly if you think about the Middle Ages, is that in the Middle Ages, global trade took place largely across a series of short, interconnected journeys, with objects passing through many hands. Although monsoon winds had long established circumoceanic trade in the Indian Ocean, it was only from the late 13th century that ships from the Mediterranean, for instance, could sail directly to England. And only from the mid to late 15th century onwards were larger and fully rigged ships from Europe able to make long distance trans or interoceanic journeys of the kind that in the 16th and early 17th centuries connected Portugal to India and beyond, Spain to the Americas, and ultimately Britain to the so-called East Indies and to Newfoundland. So that's a key issue, trade and this idea of kind of short journeys. A second key issue is that of recycling, whereby precious goods were repurposed on multiple occasions, in the process losing all or most associations with their place of origin. This is exemplified by precious metals and stones, as found, for example, on this really extraordinary crown associated with Princess Blanche of England, and probably made in Paris or Prague in the 1370s. It's now in Munich. So in the 14th century, much of the gold that circulated in Europe ultimately originated in West Africa, or was extracted from new mines in Slovakia and Hungary. And Laurie's already spoken a little bit about this in the introduction. But we also know that gold objects were constantly pawned, melted down, and repurposed, so that for all we know, the gold used for this crown could ultimately derive from mines in Scotland, Wales, Cornwall, or elsewhere, exploited by the Romans, but largely exhausted by the Middle Ages. Likewise, it has been shown that most precious stones and pearls in medieval Europe came from mines in India, Sri Lanka, or nearby seas, but such stones were also constantly recycled. So we can't say that these objects were necessarily coming into 14th century England. They could have been hanging around in treasuries, repurposed on multiple occasions, and many of them could even have come in the Roman period. But what is, I think, kind of interesting but also frustrating about precious stones like this is that their hard, shiny surfaces reveal little about their histories. Histories of extraction, exploitation, transportation, labor, and commodification that transformed free matter from the earth into prized and precious objects. So that's why in this lecture I'm going to focus on metamorphosis, and on objects that have been transformed, carved, or remounted in the course of their journeys to or from Britain. Not only does this process of metamorphosis help us to fix objects in a particular place and moment, as we cannot really do for spices or precious stones, But it also provides evidence of the reception of these objects and of close artistic engagement and scrutiny, as we will see. So the point is that all these objects have been modified in some ways in the kind of the histories of their mobility, and those modifications mean that, for one thing, artists and craftsmen are engaging very, very closely with these objects. You know, they're not just sitting up in a kind of display cabinet, but the way that they repurpose these objects, as we'll see, tells us something about the way that they valued them. And I put on last week's lecture, there was a comment about scales, which is very kind of pertinent to this digital world. So just so you get a sense of the relative scales of the objects I'm going to talk about, I put them here approximately to scale. So Britain's relationship with medieval Europe has been studied exhaustively in the past two centuries. So in this lecture, I really want to look beyond the borders of Europe, using these five objects, though really they're kind of object types, to tell a story about Britain's place in the medieval world, but without, I hope, placing Britain necessarily in the centre of that world. I don't want to re-inscribe a kind of Britannocentric or Anglocentric view of medieval history. So my first object that I'm going to talk about is this, the Luck of Edenhall. It'll be very familiar to some of my students who've worked on this. This is a relatively small glass vessel that you can go and see in the V&A at the end of their medieval and Renaissance galleries. And I do recommend, if you haven't ever looked at it, that you do go and look at it for yourself, because what these photos, which are very beautiful photos on the V&A website, don't really capture is the fragility of it. I mean, this is such a fragile glass object. It's so delicate, and the magic of this object, and I will talk about the magic of this object in a moment, I think stems from that sense of fragility. So it's called the Luck of Edenhall, in part because it was first documented in the 1670s in the possession of the Musgrave family at their house in Edenhall in Cumbria. Those are early records of it, associate it with a legend as well, that basically if this shattered, so too would that this would bring bad luck on the inhabitants of Edenhall. But what interests me about this object, well, there are several things that interest me, but one is that we know, although it's only documented from the 1670s, we have this purpose-built leather case for it, which must date to the late 14th or probably the 15th centuries. And I think what's one of the striking things about this, I think, is that if we look at the the design on this case is pretty standard, it must be said, for leather cases. And these kind of objects have been made for most precious objects in the Middle Ages. But there is, I think, a kind of conversation that takes place between these relatively kind of standardized motifs that you find on the leather object and these vegetal patterns that you find on the original glass vessel. You can also see that on the lid of this case, we have in this ribbon script, the IHS, that the name, the monogram of Christ, that in the late Middle Ages was commonly ascribed with magical or apotropaic powers. And these, this, I think, suggests, first of all, that people were always very nervous about this object breaking, but secondly, that maybe it already had these kinds of talismanic associations in the Middle Ages, although they're better recorded from the 17th century onwards. So what is this extraordinary glass vessel, and why was it prized? Well, it's of a type that's actually manufactured quite widely in the Levant and Eastern Mediterranean in the 14th and 13th centuries, particularly associated with workshops in Egypt or Syria. And I'm showing you two examples here, both of the kind of vessel with a very similar shape and one with relatively similar decoration. But I think what must have appealed to the owners of this object in England, at least by the 15th century, was that this kind of coloured, enamelled, transparent glass was something that simply couldn't be made in England at that date. So this was a marvel, of a technological marvel that couldn't be rivaled. And in fact, we can find evidence scattered and shattered that there were other kinds of glass vessels made in Egypt and elsewhere that also found their way to England. And here I'm showing you, you can see a heavily damaged object that was recovered from a 15th century rubbish pit in Abingdon in Oxfordshire, and this quite small glass vessel that's now in the Museum of London, but was probably made in Syria. So when we start to look for these kinds of objects, we can find them coming in perhaps surprising numbers, both in Britain, but also more widely in Europe. In fact, I would say that the numbers of these objects in Britain are much smaller than they are for, particularly for places like Venice, but also even Germany. And here I show you another version or a very similar object that's kept now in Cologne, which also you can see has its leather case. Whoever displayed this, I think, must have been nervous about its putting it the right way around, so it's been inverted. But you can see that, you know, this is actually a relatively common type. And so we can think of it as one of a number of objects that come from Islamic, or perhaps we should say an Arabic contexts, that found their way to England and the British Isles in the Middle Ages. These objects don't seem to have been compromised by their association with Islam. These were, in most cases, luxury or prestigious items, just like a we might think of it as a kind of Persian rug today. And in many cases, we can identify their point of origin because they've got script, Arabic or pseudo-Arabic script. And in many cases, they seem to have carried apotropaic associations, the ability to ward off evil. Arabic culture throughout medieval Europe was celebrated as a kind of center of scientific learning, but that included learning about magic, derived ultimately from Greek learning. So I'm showing you these examples, but actually in this lecture I'm not going to dwell on contacts with the Islamic world, because that will be addressed in much greater depth by Amanda Leister in the next lecture, and nor am I going to talk very much about silks either. There is an important story about the Silk Roads and England's relationship with it. But for one thing, they're extremely difficult to photograph. The very small number, for instance, of Chinese silks that have been identified in England, it's just very difficult to get a sense of them from photographs. So I'm going to leave those aside and really focus on these five objects. But what I do want to acknowledge is that it's not, this story is not only about objects coming to Britain, but also about patrons and objects moving around the world. So we might think of pilgrimage being kind of one classic means by which ideas are circulating in the Middle Ages. We've already talked about trade, crusade was certainly another one. And here we can see the epitaph of Sir Hugh Wake, who took part in the siege of Ascalon in the 13th century, and repurposed this Fatimid inscription that records the construction of a tower there, and had a mason chisel onto it his family arms. So we can see this very deliberate kind of clash of languages, if you like. In Spain, they would very often use the reverse of an epitaph or an inscription like this. But here, I've never seen the back of this. I don't know if they could have done that. But there seems to me something very deliberate about placing the arms of a crusader over an inscription like this and turning it on its side at the same moment. But I want to move to my second object, which in some ways is very closely related to the Luck of Eden Hall. It's a coconut cup. It's now kept at Eton College. Like the Luck of Eden Hall, it's a precious vessel in some ways that has come from afar and been repurposed. I've chosen this out of many coconut cups because it bears an inscription around the lip, which you can perhaps see here, that records that it was given by John Edmonds, professor of theology, who was a fellow of the college at Eton. In fact, we know that he was elected fellow in 1491, and that he died in 1526. So this gives us a kind of a time range for this object. And in fact, if we look at the inventories of Eton College, and inventories are a really important source for us in understanding the kind of richness of collections in the Middle Ages, many objects that no longer survive. We can see that this was in fact just one of several coconut cups that was kept at Eton College. And we can see here an inventory of the 1530s, that they had item a nut with a cover standing upon three eagle's feet, holy gilt. So that's not this one, it had an eagle's feet. Another one, item, a great standing nut with a cover, holy gilt, standing upon three hearts in the foot. And then another one with a St. Christopher in the top of the cover. So none of those records this coconut cup, in fact. But what you get a sense of, I hope, from these kind of inventory, these quite kind of jejune inventory entries, is that these were relatively commonplace items. An institution like Eton had several coconut cups. And inventories are an interesting source because they establish in many ways a kind of global cartography of their own. In many other inventories, these are described as nuts of India. And in fact, in inventories, we find descriptions of a whole range of goods that were given, were scribed, sometimes real, sometimes fictitious, points of origin for treasured goods from Baghdad, Damascus, Tartary, India, Byzantium, Antioch, Seville, Lucca, Venice, Cyprus, Genoa, Arras, Paris, and elsewhere. So these inventories suggest to us a kind of a world that certainly extended well beyond Britain's shores, but indeed beyond the borders of Europe. And in fact, there survive a considerable number of coconut cups from medieval contexts in England. Many of them survive in Oxbridge colleges and other educational establishments. I was at New College, Oxford, a few weeks ago, where they've got three, a few other places like Winchester College, we know, had lots of them. And these, we know, were placed on high table in the early modern period alongside ostrich eggs, nautilus shells, exotic vessels for salt, and so forth, like a kind of cabinet of curiosities. So these are, at one level, kind of elite objects of curiosity and wonder. But on the other hand, as Kathleen Kennedy has shown, written sources from the mid-13th century onwards suggest that actually these were relatively common objects owned by fishmongers, widows, and up to the level of kings. So it's not quite true to say these were common objects. You know, the very fact that you choose to mount them in silver and often gild that silver suggests that these were high prestige objects. But actually, in inventories and wills from the 1250s onwards, you can find records of hundreds of these coconut cups. They were coming in considerable numbers. The Eton College one is unusual only insofar as we can fix with some confidence a date for it and that it's relatively early. So why this fascination for coconut cups? Well, we know that coconuts in the Middle Ages were prized for their medicinal value, particularly the milk and the flesh of the coconut. And Kathleen Kennedy has suggested that we think about this as a kind of repurposing of the container of that medicine in the same way that, for instance, ceramic Albarello jars that were used in pharmacies and so on were often repurposed as vases and other kinds of objects. Most of these coconut cups and coconuts probably came from India. We can track them in port manifestos and so on. Came into the Red Sea and then into Venice and into the rest of Europe. And what's, I think, quite striking is that the examples from Britain, we find that most of those coconuts, they polish them up. You know, coconuts, as you probably know, they don't look like this. You have to, they've scooped out the flesh and then they've polished them. Sometimes they may even have painted them. They seem to like this dark quality. But that seems to be particular to Britain. And I show you here, really, for no better reason than I love it. This coconut cup that's now in the V&A from Ulm, but it's one of a series of coconuts made in Germany where they've carved into the shell of the coconut. And here you can see they've created this wonderful kind of feathery pattern. And I just love the idea of this kind of flapping ostrich egg on the high table. A conversation piece, I'm sure, and even the British ones may have served a similar function. But I want to underline this point, that these objects which speak seductively to us in some ways of the global reach of Britain or of the global networks in which Britain was entangled, that these objects are travelling in multiple routes. We don't have direct contact in this period between England and India, or England and Egypt, in fact. These objects and their movement is mediated by a whole series of middlemen, if you like. And here I show you this wonderful Petrus Christi painting that's in the Met of a goldsmith in his shop. This, it's been suggested, may in fact be James II of Scotland buying a ring for his bride, Mary of Guelders. But what's interesting, or particularly interesting for our purposes, is that insofar as we understand this to be a kind of remotely reliable view of the interior of a goldsmith's shop, we can see here that we've got all manner of precious and exotic items, including coconut cup, you can see there, but also pearls and gems, coral, rock crystal, and other precious or exotic items. So goldsmiths, I think, play an important role as conduits of these foreign objects. And probably, must have been responsible for setting this, my third object, in a new mount, probably in the late 15th or early 16th century. And this object takes us further afield because the item that's been remounted here is a Celadon bowl made probably in northern China in the Lopwan Kilns. This is a piece of glazed stoneware, in its original context, actually not a particularly precious object, but on arrival in England, probably in the late 15th, early 16th century, was clearly thought to merit this new mounting. And this I've chosen really as one of the earliest examples of Chinese porcelain that we can trace in Western Europe. Chinese porcelain has long been known to Arabic travelers, but wasn't really fully described until Marco Polo did so in the late 13th century. And this is one of the very earliest examples of it in Britain. If we compare it with our coconut cup from Eton, and if you look particularly at the kind of mounts that you see here with these very distinctive foliage designs, or you look at the base with this kind of beading, actually I think it's quite possible that this was mounted by the same goldsmith, these two objects, a goldsmith with access to these kinds of precious objects in the same way as we saw in that Petrus Christi's painting. But this ranks as the third earliest piece of Chinese or intact Chinese porcelain that we can track with any certainty in medieval Europe. The oldest is this vase, the so-called Fonthill vase. It has an interesting story. It was owned and kept at one point at Fonthill Abbey. This is a much more precious piece of Chinese porcelain with this high relief. But we know from this 18th century watercolour by Barthélemy Rémy that it had it was originally mounted. And in fact, the heraldry on those mounts suggests a connection between the Hungarian king, Louis the Great, and it's been suggested on the basis of this heraldry that it was a gift by King Louis the Great to Charles of Durazzo to celebrate his succession to the Kingdom of Naples in 1381. In fact, 4 years later, he'd seize the throne of Hungary. So we can say with some security that this jug was in Europe by the late 14th century, possibly earlier. There's lots of other porcelain in collections that's not mounted, where it's very difficult for us to know at what point it arrived. But here we have a valuable example. And the next oldest example is this, another Celadon bowl mounted in gilt silver and now in Germany. And we know that it was in the possession of Philip von Katzenellenbogen, and that he made a pilgrimage to Acre in the Holy Land in the 1430s. We also know that Acre was an important kind of entrepot where goods from East Asia could be acquired. So it's almost certain that he acquired this in Acre in the 1430s, brought it back to Germany and had it mounted. But I think what's significant to me about these objects, these kind of very early traces of contact, albeit at several removes with China, is that they predate an absolute explosion of Chinese porcelain that arrives in England or Britain in the 16th century. Again, we only can identify those ones that are in the 16th century largely because either they're recorded in inventories or other written sources, or because they have the 16th century mounts. A lot of them have marks that indicate that they're made in England. Pretty much all of these made between the 1560s and 1600. So we have this moment when, as it were, Britain opens up to a much greater extent with imports from China. And some of that, it seems likely, came not necessarily directly from trade with China, which does begin but a little bit later, but with is owed to Portuguese trade with China. Which really begins in the mid-16th century. And indeed, some of this porcelain we know was acquired by English pirates who sacked Portuguese galleons laden with Chinese porcelain. So they come via a circuitous route, but this porcelain was highly prized in 16th century England. Again, because they didn't know how to make it. Actually, we have the right clays, you can make it, and in the 18th century, they go wild and make lots of this kind of chinoiserie. But at this point, they sometimes call it shell. They thought it came from a shell. This hard, glossy surface, this blue and white, was very highly prized. And it's worth saying that some of that seems to have come from Portuguese galleons, but significant quantities may also have come via Ottoman Turkey. I mentioned before that Arabic travellers had long known about Chinese porcelain. There were huge collections of Chinese porcelain, for instance, in Baghdad from the 11th century onwards. But the Ottoman rulers also built up very substantial collections of Chinese porcelain. And in the late 15th century, potters in Iznik in Western Anatolia also found a way to glaze vessels in a way that imitated Chinese porcelain. And that's what we see here, actually. These objects, which in many ways resemble those examples of Chinese porcelain, these are made examples of Iznik jobs made in Western Anatolia, some of them in their decoration imitating that Chinese porcelain, but some of them experimenting with these really wonderful kind of vibrant colours that are quite different from the Chinese tradition. And I think, I'm very interested in these objects because I think they speak to this kind of moment in the 16th century when we can start to talk about these properly global networks, but I think they also underline how, until the late 16th century, Britain was very much at the periphery of these Eurasian networks that included the old Silk Roads, the Black, Red, and Mediterranean seas, and the Persian Gulf, and later the Portuguese routes round the Horn of Africa. We can find much larger quantities of Chinese porcelain, for instance, in Portugal in this date, and England is still on the periphery. But its position does mean that it was also a kind of contact zone, receiving goods from what has sometimes been called the global north. For our purposes, consisting of a network, really, of traders in fur, walrus teeth, and other goods in Scandinavia, Russia, Iceland, Greenland, and even Newfoundland. And one symptom of this contact with this global north is the arrival in England of ivory teeth from Arctic animals, including this long tooth from a knoll, which probably, maybe it's slightly larger than it is in real life, I've lost my sense of scale, but only slightly longer than it is in real life. But this is properly the tooth of a narwhal with its distinctive long straight form, but then twisting up a section, which you can see here. These narwhals probably weren't hunted. They're quite elusive creatures, but it's thought that these teeth may have been particularly found from narwhal carcasses. They're hunted by killer whales, and their carcasses might have been beached. And in fact, remarkably, a pair for this object that's now in the V&A also survives in the World Museums in Liverpool. If we look, it's very difficult to show this because it's such an awkward shape for slides and so on. But if we zoom in on different parts of it, onto the top part, you can see the way that the craftsman has adapted this design. Can't have been someone who was very accustomed to carving narwhal tusks because there simply weren't enough of them. But if we look at the lower section of this tusk, then we can see this extraordinary sequence of scrolling vines with nude figures and birds and so forth. And if we compare that, for instance, to something like the Western portals at Lincoln Cathedral, carved in the mid-12th century, we can see very similar kinds of forms, which suggests that this narwhal tusk was carved in England, probably in the mid-12th century. And incidentally, just as we've got it on the screen, this portal at Lincoln, which is very closely related to the portals of Saint-Denis in northern France. What you can also see here is something that I think that Amanda will be talking about in next week's lecture, these confronted birds in roundels, which is an absolutely kind of classic feature associated with Islamic silks. So these objects are speaking to the north, to the south, and in all directions. We don't know what this was used for. You can see that these little holes that look like it might have had perhaps metal bands or something that twisted around the tusk and the same at the center here. And it may be, although I'm not completely convinced by this, suggested that it was used as a kind of candle holder. You can see in this wonderful painting, also in the Met, these deacons holding these long, slender tapers. The longer the taper, the more prestigious, but what was quite common in the Middle Ages is that you would find a kind of supporter for that taper that resembled it. And if you look in detail, I hope you can see the kind of characteristic twisting forms of a narwhal tusk. So you would spike your wax candle to the top of it and then be able to create these very impressive forms. So there are some signs of scorch marks and so on of these that suggest that they might have been used as candle holders. But we also know famously that certainly from the mid 14th century onwards, narwhal tusks were associated with the unicorns and with the power to neutralize poison. So you can see two famous examples of that here. But in the 12th century, when these were carved, there's no evidence that they were thinking about these tusks in relation to unicorns or poison. This animal on the left you might not immediately recognize, but I do, I'm very fond of this miniature from the Westminster bestiary, which shows a walrus. Because it's important to underline the fact that narwhal is just one form of animal tooth that's coming into Britain in the Middle Ages. Notably, walrus ivory, which was widely used in medieval Britain, particularly up until the 13th century, but beyond that as well. We know that, well, it's thought that in the Middle Ages there might have been walrus colonies in the Outer Hebrides, but certainly walruses were hunted and traded widely across this global north. And as an example of this, I think I particularly like the example of the Lewis chess pieces, some of them now in the BM, some of them in the National Museum of Scotland, which are carved mainly out of walrus ivory, although some of them are carved from the teeth of sperm whales. And so these objects speak, they were found in the Outer Hebrides in the 19th century, but they speak again to this place of contact. We have the game of chess, which originated in Iran or India, by the time that these were made, had spread to the Outer Hebrides, and these were realized in the tooth or the ivory of walruses. So we've got ivory coming from these Arctic animals, but also in the Middle Ages, and particularly from the 13th century onwards, we have ivories coming from particularly African elephants in England. Here's Matthew Paris's really wonderful drawing, clearly done from observation of an elephant that had been gifted via the circuitous route to Henry III in 1254. It was kept at the Tower of London, and then ultimately its bones are buried somewhere at Westminster Abbey. But here I'm showing you one of the rare examples of an ivory, elephant ivory, that we know was carved in England. This one bears the arms of John Grandison, who was Bishop of Exeter in the 1330s. So we can see again the way that Britain's particular position means it's connected to these multiple networks in the north and in the south. And if we look at the distribution of narwhals or walruses, or think about those trade routes for sub-Saharan, from sub-Saharan Africa through the Sahara Desert, bringing ivory into Spain, the Mediterranean, and then ultimately into England, we can see how using the kind of distribution of these animals, we can think about the globality of Britain in the Middle Ages, if you like, or if you probably don't like that horrible term. But I mean, interesting also to think about the way that these patterns have shifted as with global warming, and against it, the ice patterns and so on. So these are the distribution of these animals changes over time. I want to turn now to my last object, which is one that Lloyd has already shown briefly in the introduction to this series. So far, I've looked at objects that arrived in Britain from afar, but it's also important to emphasize that objects and materials were also exported from England or taken from England as gifts or for other purposes. So if we think about the kind of primary export goods from Britain in the Middle Ages, they include tin mined in Cornwall and used across medieval Europe. It's quite rare in Europe. Alabaster, quarried and carved in the Midlands and distributed across Europe from Iceland to Portugal or Croatia. Wool, cloth, and precious embroideries, particularly the kind of embroidery known as Opus Anglicanum, which also spread across medieval Europe. But this particular object, in fact, travelled further afield. It's one of a group of objects that are linked in different ways, but particularly through their manufacture. These jugs, and I'm showing them approximately to scale, in some cases bear heraldry and emblems that allow us to link them to date them to the late 14th century, although, or possibly a little bit afterwards. And they also bear a series of inscriptions, kind of homely wisdom, such as the one that you see on the Robinson jug now in the V&A. God's grace be in this place, amen. Stand away from the fire and let just one come near. So you might wonder why I should, out of these examples, choose this one, which is now in Leeds City Museum. But there are two reasons, really. One is that this is one of two jugs that was found in the 1880s, in fact, at the base of a sacred tree. We don't know exactly where, in Kumasi, in what is now Ghana, probably in the palace of the king of the Asante, or possibly in the nearby royal mausoleum. But here you see it together with that other vessel from the British Museum. A few years later, a third item was retrieved. And when I say retrieved, I mean stolen and taken back to Britain. So these objects, we know, were in West Africa in the late 19th century, but we don't know how they got there. There were no direct contacts between England and West Africa in the 14th and 15th centuries. And we do know there was plenty of trans-Saharan travel, that gold is going in one direction and things like copper in the other direction. But we do know that there was direct contact with West Africa and Portugal in the early 16th century. And we know, in fact, that the Portuguese gave all sorts of gifts to their trading partners of this type. And so it has been suggested that maybe these came via Portugal. It's also significant that Portugal and England had a very strong diplomatic and trading relationship in the 14th and 15th centuries, which might explain how these vessels had got there in the first place. But the short answer is we don't know exactly how they ended up there. But I've chosen this one because it's the one example of an object that was modified whilst in Ghana. The lid here, which I've not had an opportunity to examine for myself, was made, it's thought, not in England, but was made in Ghana. So this isn't an object that's undergone this kind of metamorphosis. And then, as Lloyd mentioned, when it came back to England, it receives this little shield that records its ownership by the Prince of Wales' own Yorkshire regiment. What I find very striking about these objects is that we can think about them in relation to a series of other objects from or in Ghana that were also made out of copper alloys. Copper was relatively rare in West Africa. It was traded for gold, in fact, we know throughout the Middle Ages. These English vessels form part of a group of copper alloy vessels from distant lands that were highly prized by Akan communities in Ghana. And these include seven brass bowls and basins made in Egypt and brought to Ghana and still associated with mythic events and powerful ceremonies. So I'm showing you here a photo by Raymond Silverman of one of these objects in Soko. When he travelled there in the 70s and 80s. He found seven of these objects. Some of them have since been stolen. But what you can see, I hope very clearly, is that this is an object that was not made in Ghana, but was made in Mamluk Egypt. It resembled something like this object that's now in the Courtauld galleries. And these objects, again, we don't know exactly when, but we can be sure that some of them were at least were there by the early 15th century, had been traded across or moved across the Sahara and were treasured as important items. And further evidence for that recognition of the special value of these objects comes from a whole series of copper vessels that were made in Ghana from probably the 16th century onwards, a lot of them from the 19th century, but which show very clearly that the artists responsible for these vessels took inspiration from these imported objects. If you look at this kuduro, an object, an ornate brass vessel, typically owned by kings and courtiers, in which gold dust and nuggets were kept. These were receptacles for their owner's kra, or their life force, and were used in ceremonies during their owner's lifetime and then left in burials. But if we look at the decoration of this with these kind of distinctive forms and roundels, I think it's clear that they represent a kind of translation of the motifs found on these Mamluk basins. Or if we look at this vessel, which I only found online earlier this week, and it was on an auction webpage. I'm not being able to find anything more about it, but this looks very strikingly similar to those jugs I've shown you from England. So we can see this response to these distant objects. And I think what interests me particularly is that the historical mobility of these objects, especially those now in England, represents a kind of complex facet in current discussions about repatriation of goods seized illegally in the colonial era. These objects and their histories also expose the ways in which colonialism confronted soldiers and scholars with artworks from beyond Europe's borders, or artworks that had been taken beyond Europe's borders. And in fact, although British antiquaries certainly contributed to the nationalistic and Eurocentric discourses that characterized so much early art historical scholarship, they also demonstrated from a very early date profound curiosity for objects from more distant lands. As testimony to this concern, we might consider Sir Christopher Wren's influential theory on the so-called Saracenic origins of Gothic architecture. He thought that Gothic architecture had derived from the Crusader experience of Islamic architecture. All the collection and discussion of West African ivories, as you see here. So these were discussed, for instance, these probably made in Sierra Leone, but discussed at the very first meeting at the Society of Antiquaries in 1731, or this horn owned by Sir Hans Sloane, very important figure in the kind of history of collecting in England. So insofar as we can talk about the discipline of art history in Britain, for example, in the 1920s or 1930s even, it's clear that it enjoyed an impressively global dimension, albeit one rooted in a colonial worldview. It was only after the collapse of European empires and the horrors of the Second World War that art historical horizons shrunk to an emphatically European dimension, as scholars urgently sought to shatter nationalistic discourses by tracing the common roots of European Judeo-Christian civilization. So I think an argument can be made that the emphasis on a kind of European history of art particularly emerges from, especially from Jewish emigre scholars like Erwin Panofsky and others, who are seeking to find this kind of common European identity after the Second World War. The objects I've discussed tonight tell powerful stories of Britain's interconnectedness with the medieval globe. But let me be very clear that they're not representative of the majority of goods and artworks that were made, gifted, repurposed, destroyed, traded, and treasured in medieval Britain. These are and were exceptional objects. They were not intrinsically precious, but became so by virtue of the human and natural processes that created them, their careful transportation across vast distances, and their subsequent rarity. They represent, to some extent, a bridge to an early modern world that was truly global, and in which each of these objects might find its place in a cabinet of curiosities. But with the exception of the narwhal tusk, and as the pastern treasure of slightly later here hints, each of those objects might equally be used or displayed for great feasts of the kind that you see represented here, where they jostled for attention with culinary marvels, and later with the sugar, tea, wine, salt, and spices that tell their own contested stories of a global Britain.
Thanks, Tom, so much for a really wonderful lecture, taking us through so many, such a wide variety of object types, not just in the examples you chose to focus on, but kind of broadening out and linking them to so many other similar examples. And I was thinking towards the end about the pastern treasure, so it was wonderful that you brought it up. But and I know you talk about it as the kind of first real global moment, but so many of the objects you showed really demonstrate that world before the pastern treasure, but really that there were so many elements of that already present in the material culture that was circulating in Britain at the time. So we've got time for questions, but as people are kind of gathering their thoughts both in the room and online, I'm just going to jump in and ask you something about the kind of remounting of some of these earlier objects that you showed. And I was thinking a bit about how in museums today, how potentially the acquisition of an object is about kind of pinpointing its in a time and place, say the Royal Gold Cup at the British Museum. You know, we want this to be an object made for a French king in the late 14th century, and although it has these other histories, they are kind of subsequent to this original history. And I thought it was very eloquent the way that you kind of begun with the Luck of Eden Hall and finished really with those Mamluk basins and with the jugs in Ghana, because in a sense their histories in England or in Ghana kind of reject the object's origins and replace it in its remounting or in its metamorphosis and its reuse with these localized histories that are either particular to a family, in the case of the luck, or to a kind of ceremonial function. And I don't know, I wondered if you might say a little bit more about what you think about that, about the ways in which the metamorphosing of these objects kind of rejects history as much as creates new ones.
Thanks, that's an interesting question. One way I think to think about some of these objects is to see them as part of a kind of a long history of the repurposing of precious objects from all sorts of different places. If you think about the treasury at Saint-Denis, which reuses Sasanian rock crystal vases or Egyptian porphyry vessels and remounts them. Or if you think about the treasure of San Marco, well, again, you have all these objects, some of them Byzantine in origin, some of them Fatimid in origin, they get remounted. I mean, I think that's just what they did with these objects. I don't think they were, you know, I have to say, although it's, I'm not sure that they knew where these objects came from, and I don't think it really mattered. I think they recognize them as precious and rare, but what they have a kind of charisma in some ways that they start attracting all these stories, like the narwhal tusks helping against poison. It's the same with celadon, as comes to be associated with that it would show you if you kind of had a poison drink and so on. The Luck of Eden Hall, I've talked about the kind of magical associations with that. Even the English vessels that go to Ghana, they seem to be used in these kind of sacred ritual context. So there is a way that these exceptional objects, which actually in their origins, you know, I said before, these the celadon's ware is, you know, this is really quite standard stuff in 15th century northern China. Same, you know, coconuts. For many people around the world, a coconut or a bit of ginger would be, you know, nothing remarkable. But it's that movement and that that process of transportation and metamorphosis which endows them with value.
I mean, I also think that, because I went with Tom to look at some of these objects in Oxford, and one thing we noticed looking at this object that you can't see in images is that it's got this kind of underglazed decoration of a kind of foliate motif in it, and there's something in the closeness of the preciousness that's also really interesting about these objects. These are clearly things, they're not like paintings to stand back from and see at an altar. They are objects to be very close to, and maybe in the case of the Luck of Eden Hall, to be shown by the person who owns it or something like that, that there's a kind of intimacy around them too. But not to hog too much of the time, I think we should open up for questions from the audience, if there's anyone who'd like to kick off. If you just 1 second, we're just going to get you a microphone.
Thank you. Two very quick questions. What is a heart case? I hope it's not what it sounds like. And secondly, the very last slide you showed, what's going on? There's not that, the man with very colourful, there was a very strange man in a blue dress.
Okay, I can try and answer those. So a heart case is what it sounds like.
Oh, is it?
Yes. It was quite common to divide up bodies in the Middle Ages after death. And Roger wanted his heart buried at St. Albans.
Thank you.
So he gets this special case. We know that there were ambassadors, there was an embassy to the Mongol ruler from St. Albans in the early 13th century. And this object, which hasn't really been studied very much, actually, well, it has been suggested it comes from Spain. I don't think anyone really knows. But it's... St. Albans, was although it's a closed monastery, was remarkably well connected to the wider world. The last image, I'm probably going to struggle more to identify these figures, because I must confess to using it principally as an image of a...
What's going on the front of that blue dress?
Oh, yeah, I mean, there's lots of... You mean this... nicely placed object. It's exactly what you think. I mean, it's not exactly, I mean, it's meant to imply exactly what you think. I suspect it's meant to be you could excuse it as the hilt of a dagger that's hidden behind. But I think that these precious objects were there to delight, but also to, there's an element of wit in them as well. And it's not actually that uncommon to find... plays like that.
Thank you.
Thank you. A well-placed question to lower the tone of the... And a question here.
Hi there. Thank you for that. That was wonderful. The kind of object-specific question, the coconut cups that you saw in Oxford, I was wondering what the interior of those were like. Were they... gilded, or were they left raw and unfinished?
Well, neither of those. So they're polished up and cleaned up, and they clear out all the flesh. But they're not gilded in the inside. On one of the New College coconuts, actually, I think it's this one, there is a little... God, what it is now. There was something at the very bottom, but most of them you just see the inside of the coconut, but it kind of cleaned up and polished and smooth. There is a suggestion that actually you having a slightly acidic wine in these coconut cups wouldn't be very wise. And I think with all these questions, with all these objects, there is a question about which I kind of wanted to get to with the final image. Are these objects that are actually used? Or are they objects that would be displayed in the manner of these of this? Are these kind of exotic novelties? I mean, we know that high table kind of feasts are moments where you have culinary, you know, extraordinary kind of culinary delights, you know, peacocks and sugar created into all sorts of kind of fantasies. And those objects themselves have come from afar. The coconut cup, I don't know yet, basically. I can't work out whether they were used. I think they might have been used on the odd occasion, but I don't think they're not. They're not the sort of, you know, they're not dishwasher proof. You don't use them on a regular basis. I think they're really there to as a kind of display plate, would be my guess.
But I guess in the case here with Jean-Duc de Berry, he's extremely wealthy and he's also demonstrating his own personal wealth through the display of plate, whereas the objects from the colleges are also kind of an index of the people who have given all these and they're belonging to this institution. And so they kind of are about binding that individual to the institution in life, in death.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, a lot of these, so in a lot of the inventories from Eton and from New College and from other institutions, you know, they record that they're given by former pupils or fellows. So these act as a kind of, you know, early form of alumni kind of advertising in a way. You know, this is the way that you get to be remembered on high table. We know that those colleges, also they have these big Gaudet feasts. In New College, we have lots of records of them where you get all your patrons and your donors and your fellows together and you have these, but also maybe in some, well, for New College, you know, the architects and craftsmen as well, you get them together and you have this big feast and it's part of, it's the way that you create a kind of a college identity. But it must be said that most of them don't record, well, at least the surviving ones don't have heraldry on them, they don't record who donated them. We only know that from inventory records. But yeah, I'm sure these are, in a way that I'm saying they're kind of these charismatic objects. They tell stories. They're objects that have stories associated with them, whether they're mythical or not. And so I think that they would be the prompt for kind of discussions about donors and so on.
Jessica,
yes.
Do you want to use my...
Just a sort of broader question. So one of about, in a way, inspired by what you said at the end about you know, these are all exceptional objects. I mean, they're more than one, but they're not typical of the production and consumption of art in the British Isles during this period. So I guess I just was wondering what your thoughts might be about how to interpret something exceptional differently than something that is less so. In each case, you might be talking about just one thing, but how does it affect your analysis of it, the outside knowledge of its unusualness?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's an important question. It's something that I kind of grapple with because, you know, particularly in this current moment, we're kind of drawn to these objects, and they, I think they have been overlooked. They haven't kind of fitted into kind of narratives about relationship with France and so on. But I think there is a danger that we misrepresent the history of the Middle Ages in Britain or anywhere else by fixing on them. I mean, what I hope to do with this is to kind of form a kind of corrective, as it were, to establish narratives of what's happening in medieval Britain. But they are a very incomplete story, and I just think that they need to have that that kind of cautionary tag. I mean, what is interesting, Kathleen Kennedy has recently published on coconut cups, and you know, with not that much looking, she's been able to overturn a narrative that said that these were exceptionally rare just by looking. And, you know, all these wills and things, they were all published in the 19th century. It was all there, but no one was looking for it. And so there is a way that this can kind of prompt, you know, they're good to think with. But I think, I do think that some kind of, we need to offer a kind of balanced view of, what was that, a kind of total view.
Yeah. Thank you.
Do we have any questions coming from online?
No, not yet, no. They're very welcome.
Mark.
Yeah, I was wanting to, if you could tell us a bit more, Tom, about you were talking about the fact that these, for instance, these eggs are being remounted. And do the particular decorative schemes within each of the individual mounts that you've been looking at, do they tell very much of particular kind of skills and motifs in a particular area or in Britain, for instance? Or do you see, is there a standard set of conventions for doing these kind of mounts for these egg cups, for instance? Or do each of the mounts tell of an embracing of this particular object by a very particular culture with its own imagery?
I've been looking at a lot of coconut cups recently, and they're not quite as interesting as I want them to be, like visually, actually. I mean, some of them are, like this one. This is from New College, and is really exceptional. And originally, we were looking at it a few weeks ago, it's got these little holes. It looks like it probably had little kind of bunnies running around the base. But this is exceptional. You know, most of them are like this. And they're pretty standard. It's the same kind of mounts they use for ostrich eggs. It's the same kind of mounts they use for the celadon. Insofar as there's anything particular about them, I mean, they are quite different, and I'm not sure why this is from the ones that are said to be made in Germany and elsewhere in Central Europe, where a lot of them they're carving into the coconut. But I wonder also if that's the kind of assumption that under more scrutiny might kind of collapse. It's so difficult to know where any of these objects come from. And as it's so often the case, you know, we have all these inventories that record these coconuts, but they never, it's very hard to match them up with examples that do survive and so on. So I think that the one way that we can locate some of those mounts is because they have hallmarks and so on. So, you know, all of these examples actually can be dated relatively, you know, to a kind of 20-year period, sometimes more precisely. They're moderately interesting, I would say. These, you know, and they represent a considerable investment. But there's not actually that much variety, I would say, in them.
But why aren't they interesting, do you think? Well, I mean, I'm striking. What is it about them that makes them uninteresting to you, or frustrates what you want to do with them?
So some of the ostrich eggs, for instance, that you get from the all the Nautilus shells. Like when you were in the 17th century, you have all these wonderful tritons kind of mounted on top of Nautilus shells. You know, the burly nests. You know, doing all sorts of interesting things. They're engaging. There's a kind of self-referentiality about the decoration of them. All Souls in Oxford have a coconut cup, an ostrich egg cup from the very early 17th century, with a little ostrich mounted on the top. They're kind of calling attention to the origins of these materials in a way that I find very interesting. But they're not doing that in the same way here. I mean, it's not fair for me to condemn that. And they, a lot of them, you know, from those Eton inventories, it seems that a lot of them had covers, like you see here, and maybe those covers would have had other kinds of imagery or whatever, but it's not. I am interested in them. I mean, I've spent the last few months kind of obsessively collecting coconut cups, but yeah, they're not. They don't. You know, if you think about, I can't think if in the Past and Treasure you see this, but not much. That much later, they really become super fun.
But do you think it's also a kind of, we talked a bit about this when we were putting together the series, it's a bit about how the relationship to art history has with these kinds of objects. You know, the painting by Petrus Christie, you can get completely lost in an object like that. I mean, it can occupy people for their careers thinking about single paintings. And there are kind of limits to these coconut cups. They can't quite possibly fit the gap left by a painting like that. But then, you know, something like the Fontal Vase does give a bit more, right? You have patrons, you have connections, you have, the 14th century. There's something different about that's giving in a way that, say, the cups aren't, because maybe they're a bit more common. They lack those patronal connections that objects like that do. So I don't know. Maybe it is something about the way that we are taught, and the way that art history has been constructed and is currently still being constructed, that
Yeah, I mean, I think we do need to think kind of outside kind of traditional paradigms for understanding these. And I think, you know, imagining the biography of an object, not just actually something like the Fontenay vase from the moment of its production through, William Beckwith and so on, you know, all these interesting owners and its arrival in the National Museum of Ireland, it was lost for a while, you know, so these objects, they have a very interesting biography, and I think it's the same with something like the coconut cups or indeed gems. I mean, I think there is a way of tracing the biography of these objects not only from the moment of their production onwards, but actually, you know, for me, I think it's very interesting to try to trace them backwards, the kind of histories of extraction, the growth of the cultivation, let's say, of coconuts, or understanding more about gem mines in Sri Lanka in the 13th century. You know, this is material we absolutely just don't know anything about. But I think what these objects do is provide a way into those kinds of histories and open paths for new research in that respect.
Just to stay with the metal mounds for the moment, because we have some interest online as well. So we have a couple of questions, but more or less they're asking about whether if we think about other cups and bowls, so why do the porcelain bowls have metal mounds? And can you sort of think about the coconut cups in relationship to other cups and bowls at the time? What does that tell you?
So that's an interesting question, because something like that Celadon bowl at New College was made as a bowl. I haven't seen it out of its mount, but I suspect it would sit quite comfortably, as would a lot of these other objects. And for all we know, lots of the bowls and jugs that are now in collections in the UK and beyond might have arrived in Europe in the Middle Ages or in the 16th century. We just don't know it because they don't have their mounts. You know, we wouldn't know that about the Fontenay vase if we didn't have this watercolour. So I think, why are they doing it? You know, in some cases to protect them, to keep them safe. You know, these are precious objects. I think this gives them a level of protection and stability. Some of them are cracked and damaged and vulnerable. I think it's a way of signalling their importance. They say it's what they do with Byzantine and Roman and other kinds of objects. Sometimes it's about repurposing them. So in the case of the Fontenay vase, I've never actually seen it myself, but you can see, I mean, here we have it as a vase, here we have it as a jug. And I have to say, I don't know much about this. I don't know if there's a hole for this spout. So whether it's, you know, they are making quite radical changes in order to use these objects differently. So I think, you know, we can't necessarily understand the kind of motives in all cases. But I mean, I would say, you know, having been slightly dismissive of some of these, you know, they are technically sophisticated. One of the challenges with these objects is that they're pre-made. You get your coconut, you get your southern vase, you're a goldsmith. You've got to fit your mount very, very tightly to that. You can't have it kind of wobbling around. So you've got to find a means to set it very in a very stable fashion, which is actually not that easy. In some of the coconut cups, you can see they've got this kind of hinged design that I think means you can kind of clip them in and make sure that they are secure. But quite possibly they wouldn't need to mount this. But I think it's just, there's a kind of accumulation of preciousness, I suppose, that comes from taking a precious object and then setting it in a kind of recognised another precious material also from afar.
Do you think then the removal of the mounts from the Fontenay vase also speaks to a moment where the kind of triumph of the Chinese mm-hmm. ceramic over the medieval says that it should be kind of, you know, preserved as it's, because it seems, I mean, I don't know, what, did they take it off to clean it or something? But, you know, they must be somewhere, these mounds.
Yeah, that's a really interesting idea. I mean, it would certainly make sense that in the, you would think that in the late 18th and early 19th century, depending on exactly where this was, after it leaves Fonthill, that actually the vogue for chinoiserie was greater than it was for medieval revival things. Although, of course, I mean, interestingly, you know, Fonthill we think of as a centre of an interest in the medieval. But yeah, I mean, we can only speculate. This object is missing for about 100 years. We don't know where it was or what happened to it. But you know, the guess is, like so many objects that fall into the hands of dealers, they make unscrupulous changes based on what they think is going to sell better. So that would be a reasonable guess, I think.
So one more question. Actually, two more questions, but on coconut cups. There's a question about the fact that a lot of the coconut cups look like chalices. Was there any intent to give a religious overture to these vessels?
So that's a very interesting question, I think. There are not from, well, you might not expect chalices to survive from England from pre-Reformation. A few do, but not very many. There are a couple of examples from Central Europe that have clearly been made into chalices, but most of them don't seem to have been. And from, again, going back to the inventories of these kind of educational establishments, you find them more in educational establishments than you do in church treasuries, which I think is interesting. But there is a, I mean, chalices, there is, but there was quite careful thought given to the materials they use for making chalices. And for whatever reason, perhaps partly because of this acidic wine, these I don't think were very often used as chalices. And it's the same with the celadon and other kind of porcelain ware. So whether that stems from kind of pragmatic concerns or a kind of anxiety about these unfamiliar materials is not clear. People, you know, on the other hand, did ascribe these kind of semi-magical powers to porcelain and exposing poison and so on. But maybe exposing the Eucharistic wine to that kind of level of scrutiny would be difficult too.
It's also a size question, really, because before the Reformation, it's only the celebrant who is participating in the drinking of the blood of Christ, the wine. So these are quite large vessels, whereas most pre-Reformation chalices are actually relatively quite small. And it's only after the Reformation you start to get much larger vessels to hold enough wine for the whole congregation. Was there another question?
Yeah, another one about the Nautilus. I think it was in a painting.
In the past and treasure.
Exactly, and I think the question is when does that come in?
So I've been talking about this with Lloyd recently. So the earliest surviving example of Nautilus shells, they only grow, they only live in Southeast Asia, around kind of Indonesia, but they start becoming very fashionable in the 16th and 17th century onwards, but. There are earlier examples that survived from the 15th century. I think they're recorded, well, they're certainly recorded in inventories from the 14th century. The BM at the moment has a cover. It's a kind of enameled metalwork cover that's in the very distinctive shape of a Nautilus. And it's suggested, and it has it has heraldry on it that means we can date to the late 13th, early 14th century, and that seems to have been made for a Nautilus shell. The shell no longer survives, but if that is the case, then I think that would be the earliest known example of a Nautilus in anywhere in Europe, actually. It's probably made in, the cover is probably made in France, but perhaps with an English connection. But they really take off, you find more and more of them, certainly in Britain in the late 16th century and then onwards, And they are wonderful, you know, things like the Berliner in the V&A. They love the, again, it's these, you know, the materials of the Nautilus shell, they're a bit like porcelain or indeed other kind of precious stones, sardonyx and things that are set into these cups. They are materials that metamorphosize before your eyes. They're not, the exact nature of the materiality isn't clear. They shine as you look at them in different directions. They look slightly different. So these kinds of mutating materials, I think, are highly esteemed. And there is an interesting connection, I think, as I said, that in the early inventories, they call porcelain, they think of it as a kind of a shell. And it has to do with this hard, shiny surface, I think. In the same, you know, it's exactly the same reason that they, or similar reason that they admired Spanish lusterware, because in Spain, they've learnt it from Islamic craftsmen, but they put in these tin glazes, tin from Cornwall, as it happens, but which gives it this kind of metallic sheen, which is something that they couldn't do at that date in Northern Europe.
I think we should bring the question part of this evening to a close, which leads me to just say thank you so much to everyone here for joining us, and also to everyone at home for joining online. Please, for those of you here, come and join us downstairs for a glass of wine, and also join me in thanking Tom again for his really wonderful lecture. Thanks, Tom.